evolved by Meritto Mumbai chapter. As kind of shared by Manish and other team members, that we organize these events largely to ensure that we bring in all educational institutions under one fold. And as you know, probably many of you would know that as we speak, we work with more than 1200 educational institutions across India. Across the board in education, we work with, like shared by Naveen in the video, we work with higher ed institutions, we work with business schools, we work with edtech companies, we work with study abroad consultants, we work with a lot of players in the K-12 and play school market as well. So it has been a journey for us, and what we are trying to do with this evolve, before I get into the discussion with respect to our topic, is that we want to bring in this entire community together in one room, so that best practices, what's going on with respect to educational institutions across all verticals, can be shared by the respective people who are driving these educational institutions with the audience. This kind of an event is very unique in India. Largely, if you look at it, you will find a lot of events where you bring in people, but you don't bring in people from across all spectrum of educational institutions. And for us, we feel that it is our responsibility as Meritto, that since all of you use our platform, majority of you, I think there are a couple of them or many of them who are not still using our platform present here, but we want to ensure that you get right insights with respect to what's happening in educational institution, what are the ways in which they are attracting and enrolling students, what are the best practices they are adopting in kind of looking at faculty members or of offering programs and all that. So that was the whole idea. I am thankful that we have got a very distinguished panel today. We've got people from across the board, as you see, from higher ed institutions, from fitness as a niche, from programs which you run, Karan, from programs which you run, ma'am, obviously. So I think for the next 45 to 50 minutes, you will get a lot of insights with respect to how these institutions are doing stuff in managing end-to-end, starting from not only enrollments, but from a curriculum standpoint, from faculty development standpoint, from marketing, and what are the best practices to ensure that there is an organization which can be created in the education space. So I'll not take too much of a time, but we'll straight away get into the discussion on the topic, the blueprint to a successful educational organization or an institution. All of you know the panel well, and I think my colleague also introduced the panel. So without getting into the too much of detail, I'll start with the first point with respect to, if you look at the blueprint, when you think about a blueprint, largely blueprint is a map. So for any kind of educational institution, or per se for any institution, be it a company or an organization, blueprint is very, very important to deep dive into what the institution is doing. And if you have to pinpoint with respect to what is the first thing which comes to your mind when you talk about blueprint, is your vision and mission as an organization, as an institution. So I'll straight away dive into the discussion, go to Deepa ma'am first, ma'am. To understand more about ma'am, you are a veteran, you spent a lot of years in building V-School as an organization what it is today. So if you have to talk about from a vision and mission point of view with respect to your institution, what it would be and how others can learn from what you have done with respect to ensuring that vision and following on that mission.
Thank you for having me here today. And it's wonderful to share with Pierre, who is sitting in the audience. And I'm looking forward to hearing what the others are going to say. As far as Wellinker is concerned, I think one of the biggest shift when we made, I mean, I'm an alumni of Wellinker as well. And when I joined in to the institution, we were also doing an MBA program that every other institute was offering. The difference was, what is it that we can do differently? The IIMs were there about 20 years before Wellinker even started off. So we were not first in the game. There was no first mover advantage. We were running another MBA program. Well, we were running it well. And we were in Matunga, which is like a hub of good educational institutions, whether it is VJTI, UDCT. So all of that was there. And we also have institutions of our own trust, which is Poddar and Ruya, which is all very well known. Apart from this, we were just running what everybody else was doing. The real shift came in the year 2000 when the dot-com industry was just about to, you know, break open. When everybody who was working with even the Unilevers of the world wanted to finally experiment with their ideas and wanted to see that into something that they can create of their own. Because until then, the thought was that you only needed money to, you know, succeed as a business person. Ideas, just ideas are not enough. At that point in time in 2000, what Verinkar did was we started a program called e-business, and we went and spoke to about 10 odd industry leaders. So some of them, the boom and the bust of the dot-com era actually happened in a very short time. Then there was a lot of consolidation, etc. So there were some industry leaders who told us, either y'all are mavericks or y'all have gone nuts, one of the two. And we can only hope you're mavericks. There was one industry leader, Mr. Ganesh Natarajan, who was at that time with Aptech and then Zensar and several others. He said, you saved me a trip to IIT Mumbai. And incidentally, that program was put together by faculty members and students who had passed out. And we said, what is this e-business about? This is about the convergence of business and technology. So I was just listening to what some of the speakers said about Meritto, and Mahesh Sharma spoke about, you know, no papers form identifying a cusp, which is the customer's side of the business. So we said there is business and there is technology, but there is nobody who understands both the languages. And there needs to be somebody who can translate this into meaningful business. And that is when we started our e-business program. And what we realized is with this, we had opened up a completely new vision for Verinkar, which is to open up areas which will make which will bring value to both the student and the industry community. And I think that has been the DNA and the footprint of Verinkar. And that's why we called ourselves V School, because then we realized that me, which is a more arrogant positioning of business schools, that I will solve all your problems, doesn't serve the purpose. And we have to collaborate with other people and bring things which are in convergence. So convergence and identifying areas which are going to come up 4 to 5 years hence is what is going to really change things. And that then became our vision. So we say that, you know, to train people in areas with inventive education, in areas where there is newness and where there is going to be a requirement for new type of talent. And from that, many things happened for Verinkar. We were no more playing the, this is my favorite way of putting it, it took a 2020 format for us to win the World Cup after a very long time. So unless you change the format and change the game, you can't really, you know, make history or redefine rules. So we changed the format. We said we will do the 5-day match. We will offer an MBA program in the way that it was being offered. But you know what? We are also going to redefine the rules. We are going to bring a different game, which is of value. Meaning it has to have value at the end of the day. And with that, I think we established what V-School stands for. From e-business, then we came on to design thinking, retail, and a whole lot of other areas, which then completely opened up a very new space. And Verinkar got its, you know, I think, impression in the mind of the people who matter, that if you want to start something new, if you want to start something which is experimental, which is bold, which is, and if you have to go to a willing lot of people, go to Verinkar first. Then whether it was vendors, whether it was the education community, or whether it was students, corporates, I think they came to us that ये लोग कुछ अलग करने के लिए तैयार रहते हैं. And I think that made all the difference. Because then people viewed us with a very different set of lens. And were not judging us for how old you are, but what new you can do.
Yeah. Very, very inspiring story, ma'am. I heard this for the first time. You guys can hear me, right? Yeah. I heard this for the first time, honestly, and I had no clue with respect to what you did in 2000. So I think many of you probably would have heard this story for the first time in terms of how Wellinger actually thought out of the box in 2000. And I intentionally actually started with Deepa ma'am, as you know that she spent so many years, and many of you
sort
have spent
of calling me a dinosaur, I think.
Because if you look at Universal, if you look at Atlas, these are upcoming schools, upcoming universities, so to say. So I felt that Deepa ma'am's perspective, coupled with ma'am Swetnana ma'am, your perspective, because you have been kind of doing a different work in the skilling side as well. So that perspective will add a value, and then I'll go to the new institution and understand from there that what they are doing in terms of establishing their mission and vision and the blueprint. So if you can share your insights with respect to your mission, vision for your organization, your institution.
Sure. Good morning to the esteemed panel members, and good morning to all of you in the room. I feel very fortunate to be a part of this panel discussion. Whilst there are going to be a series of discussions happening during the day, and each of these panel discussions are going to bring in different views, I feel fortunate to be a part of the panel discussion which is going to talk about blueprint for a successful higher education institute. And whilst Meritto offered this panel to me, I know the definition of a blueprint. I thought, let me just go back to Google and just confirm that once again, am I getting that right? And very rightly said, it's about maps, it's about direction, it's about a blueprint is about a photogenic kind of a map that is available so that you achieve what you embarked on. And then I realized, I said, I think we all need to congratulate Meritto as a team to put this theme in place. The reason why I say this is, when we are talking about a blueprint for a manufacturing organization, maybe that blueprint, if embedded with technology, can go for and can be used for a couple of years. But the industry that we are all talking about today is about a 21st century student who is empowered and who knows exactly the learning outcomes of his career. And even if we have technology there, I don't think we can have a blueprint that is going to last for a couple of years. We need to keep redefining this blueprint, because the student is going to ask for something new every time. So I think Meritto needs to put in such conversations very often, so that thought leaders, we meet, we discuss, we understand and take best practices home. Coming back to the vision statement, I think, my dear friends, every organization and the educational institutions are no different. We have a vision. A vision is where we want to get to, a dream where we want to get to. And my school, the Kohinoor Business School, also has one. And the Kohinoor family stems from the family of the ones who brought in skill development into the country 40 years ago, when probably India was not even thinking about skill development. And whilst we have a lot of the KTIs spread all over the country, we also have two management institutes in the country. The one that I represent is the Kohinoor Business School, where we are controlled by the university setting. Despite that, we try our, everything that we could go out to ensure that we live by the vision statement. So our mission vision statement talks about creating socially sensitive leaders with a global perspective. Now, as I mentioned to you that when we talk about a vision statement, we talk about where we want to go, what we want to be looked at as. And here I will resonate this word to the word outcome. So this is what I want, the final outcome of whatever we are doing. For that, I need to put in small pathways, small missions in place to achieve that. And that is what I call the experiences that I'm creating for my students. So if I create quality experiences, automatically the final outcome is going to be there. So as an educational institution and as a part of the Kohinoor Business School, we ensure that all the experiences that we create for our students, and I'll be talking about it in the Robin's Round that is going to come moving ahead, is all directed towards ensuring that the vision statement is met whilst keeping the quality of those experiences as high as possible.
Sure, interesting. Karan, what has been your experience looking at creating a blueprint as well as what you are driving with respect to your school?
So, am I audible at the back? Awesome. So firstly, thank you so much for having me on this panel. And just to tell you a little more about the vision, I'll tell you a little bit about my organization first. I run an organization known as IIDE. We are one of India's leading contributors to digital marketing talent through our PG programs and certification programs. We're based out of Mumbai and Delhi. Now I'll just go back to why IID was started. I was actually studying at Howard University in 2014. And the subjects that I had that time was e-commerce, similar to e-business. And I was doing a project. And the project was on e-commerce growth in India.
Which year was this?
2015, ma'am. So it was e-commerce. So it's like many years after you started e-business as a concept, but it was e-commerce growth in India. And while I was doing that entire study, two things were really coming off on Google search. One of them was Mr. Modi and his mission for digital India. There was this one keyword which was continuously across every billboard, you know, across everywhere. And the other thing that was coming off on the internet everywhere was Mr. Mukesh Ambani's plan for Jio. Right. And I think that that drastically not only revolutionized IID, but even Meritto or any such organization, because we were paying 250 rupees per, I mean, we were paying like our monthly bills were $1,000 a month for like 4 GB of internet data. And now I think everybody is either using free Jio SIM cards, which doesn't exist anymore, but I'm sure many people did. But internet has become like India is one of the cheapest countries for internet data today. So I think these two points, and of course COVID, but that time in my research, these two points were strongly coming into my project. And I realized, and I could easily tell in my project, that that time we were 29 crore online Indians, and the projection in that report which I was reading was going to say that we were going to cross 75 crore Indians by 2019 or something, which is true. Today we've crossed that number. So very simply, before going to Harvard, my specialization was in digital marketing. I did jobs in digital marketing, and I could totally tell that the digital marketing industry in India is going to absolutely exponentially grow just because of the user count growing and internet becoming cheaper. So because I had a little background in digital marketing and I liked education as an industry, my great grandfather owned a college in Mumbai, owned a couple of colleges and schools in Mumbai. So there was some relation to education and there was some relation to digital marketing. I thought it's best to leave the USA, come back to India, and set up a school which is IIDE, very specifically targeting one niche, which was digital marketing. And over the last 8 years, we've come out and, you know, we've said, okay, e-business is also a large keyword. But for us as a new age school, being micro niched, which is not only e-business and management, which is a large keyword today, we said we'll go within the niche of e-business and management into one niche, which is digital marketing, and, you know, try taking over, you know, the country and supplying great quality talent for the fresher segment out there. So it's been an 8-year journey. It's been very micro-niched. We've decided to stay within our niche and supply really good quality talent over there. And just being in the niche and just doing one thing repetitively and practicing the same thing again and again just makes us better by the day. I think that's our key.
Yeah. I think that's quite unique, Karan. I must say that you picked the right thing in 2015. Yeah. You've become very successful now. So let me just go to Kalyani, ma'am, and understand from her. So we have got a niche story here from Karan. And once you hear from her, you will realize that how niche she can go with respect to what she has to offer.
Yeah, hi. Thank you so much for inviting me here. And I'm really grateful to be with all of you. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, better. So I started out as a physical trainer, but when I wanted to do the training, I could not find a single course. So I happened to meet Lina Mogre, who has been actually the pioneers to start fitness education in India, on a trek where she told me, oh, you are very active and this thing. So I said, yeah, I'm looking for a career in sports. So I've been a kabaddi player. So she said, why don't you join my course? That's where I met Kaizad. Kaizad is the founder. We have four founders in K11, Kaizad Kapadia, me, Devki Kimchi and Mayur Sabnis. So we actually started gym management and company, and we had our own gyms. And we continuously needed manpower for that, because each gym that you have, you at least require 10 trainers. And back then you had no courses, you had certifications. The difference between a certification is you buy the books, you study, you appear for exam, and you will be surprised, there is no practical exam. It's only theoretical. So you are like hiring a driver with no experience. So that's something Kaizad was never agreed to. So we decided to set up a school, and he said, I cannot set up a school without a practical lab, that is a gym floor. So we set up the entire school in 2003 in Santa Cruz, where we had one lecture room and one practical lab. So where the course started with 2 months, 1 month of theory and 1 month of practical. And as we started research and we grew, now the course is of 6 months, 4 months of theory and 2 months of practical, because we know that we are dealing with the human body and there are a lot of aspects to it. And so we have a vision of making sure that the end customer, the personal trainer's clients, get the best of the trainers who has the scientific knowledge, theory, as well as the application, because in a lot of places in fitness education, the application is missing. They don't teach you how to apply what you learn. So that's what our main vision is, to make sure that we provide that. With that, we have also nutritionist courses where the application again comes into picture. And as I am on the management platform, we do have a gym management course where I started the course because I have managed the gyms, but there is nobody to explain you how to do that, because the whole gym management structure is different, and people would hire gym managers or even trainers for the time that they can spare for their duty. So 6 to 2 aa sakte ho, aa jao. Like that, the trainers were selected before. Now we have changed that, and unless you have a certificate, so earlier anybody could get hired. Like I'm a coach, kabaddi coach, I can get hired as a trainer, whether I have a knowledge of anatomy, physiology, kinesiology or no. And so it's changed that, and now everybody asks for certificates. Also, we have a register of exercise professionals now in India, so everybody gets listed there. So we did a lot of work on getting that streamlined too. So in 2003 when we started, I don't think there was a sector called fitness education existed, but now there is, and I'm proud to be initiator for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for actually sharing the complete story. I think it's very helpful for people to understand how you started, and where are we today?
So I like the way he used a term called micro niche. I mean, we've got a lot of offers saying ki ye bhi karo, wo bhi karo. So we always choose saying we do this the best and we want to stick to this.
In fact, that reminds me that when we meet our educational partners, all institutions, many of them have that expectation that you've got CRM, you've got application, aap ERP bhi karo, aap ye bhi karo, aap wo bhi karo. But then we go back and say that our niche is this and we'll focus on this to ensure that we support you in a better way with respect to your marketing outcomes, with respect to your student engagement, with respect to what all we do. So thank you so much for sharing that. Let me just quickly touch base with both the new age universities because they'll have also something to share with respect to how they have learned and how they have come up. So ma'am, with you and then I'll come
to
new ages.
Thank you. So I think I'm probably the youngest university on the panel. So Atlas Skill Tech University is only 2.5 years young. So we were launched in 2021. But we go back a decade. And that is when in 2013, we launched something very radical and transformative at that point because we began ISDE and ISME, which is a design school and a management school that was not offering degree programs. And for an Indian market, that was really, really radical because we said, come learn with us through our diploma course and you will do a distance education degree with the leading university in Mumbai. And what we will teach you is skill building and application oriented learning. And while we were apprehensive, I think the response was very, very encouraging. And of course, the long-term goal was to start a university. But I think we all know in India, good things do take some time. We just took a decade. So, you know, that's when Atlas was formally launched as a skill building and as a you know, state private university. You know, you mentioned, ma'am, about how trainers, physical trainers were hired and what was the process. And that got me thinking that the youth today also, which is the 18 to 21 undergraduate population, does not want to just memorize, learn, spill out in an exam and get ready or job ready, right? I mean, that's, we've all been through that process in our younger years, but definitely that's not something what we enjoyed. And that is where I think we came with a new vision and a mission that our learning approach is going to be experiential. And it's definitely going to be focused on skills, but the entire piece is either you're job ready or you're a job creator ready. And that was the entire focus through the entire piece of our university's existence. What really sets us apart again is that our ecosystem has a design school, has a management or a business school, and we also have a digital technology school, which again, you know, makes it a very multidisciplinary learning. And as we go along through the discussions, I'll be happy to share more about how the student engagement has been also very unique. I'll pass it on to you and then of course we can take this forward. Thank you.
So let me not shy away and confess that I have come in more of as a learner than as a speaker, and I'm really very privileged to be a part of this diverse panel. So I would take and absorb the learnings. That's very important for me. And we started with a very humble beginning. In fact, I'm pretty sure I can take that claim that we are not even a year old as a university. So I think that would be second, at least should be second. So we are not even a year old university. We started as a business school with a soul, and you would be surprised. This was just a decade back where we had only 10 students on campus, and with a great compelling vision and with the outcome of important stakeholders. Today, we are transformed to be a university. It has been very challenging. So we started with a business school and the vision was more about disseminating knowledge. I'm sure when you are a small business school, you cannot directly have a radical shift. But over a period of time where we thought of rather than disseminating knowledge, we will be the knowledge creators. And that's why we believed more in collaboration. We had more global partners. We had many more organizations. And that's how we transformed. And now since we all know that AI is the future, and we say the future is here, and that's how we have started with the AI University. So we are going to have 5 business schools. We are going to start with School of Design this year. And of course, like you did talk about the blueprint, which should be ready with any organization, whether in higher education, we will also get into School of Law. We'll also have International Diplomacy. We may have School of Sports. But to start with, we have started with Emerging Technologies. We have the School of Management. We have the School of Design. And we plan to add some more schools to that. So of course, all I would love to say is that a vision may be very compelling, but you need the support of all the stakeholders. And I would like to thank Meritto, you know, for connecting all the important stakeholders in this room. And I think it's not only the institution alone that can create value. I think it's time to collaborate, go beyond the boundaries, and to co-create more value. So thank you for that.
I think thank you so much for giving me space to come to the next discussion with respect to stakeholders, because you've got a blueprint at the top. Now, if you look at from an educational institution point of view, there are 2 important stakeholders. One is the student, other is the faculty. There are many, but these 2 are prime stakeholders in an educational institution. So, Deepam, I'm coming to you again, that students play a pivotal role. And as you know, that with so many alternatives available now with respect to looking at your program or a degree or a diploma, or not only within India, outside as well, with so much of money coming in the market, with so much of ease of loans and all that, how do you ensure that the needs of the students and parents are kept in the center when you think about imparting any kind of program or any kind of education services to the students? What has been your V-School's motto here with respect to driving this?
So, when it comes to V-School, I think the visionary leadership of Dr. Salunke has also played a very important role in this. But I would say that student centricity has been the motto right from the beginning. Like when I said, when we launched the e-business program, it was the alumni who came back and helped us put together this program. Student engagement, when they are in the campus, when we had this model way back, which was build, transfer and support. So you build them, you transfer them to industry or workplace, and then you support them. But we put it into practice, and how do we remain relevant to the student community was something that we've constantly focused on. One of the ways that we do that is student as a stakeholder in important growth initiatives at the institute, whether it is starting a new program, whether it is about engaging with industry. You will find that the boardroom where the faculty industry leaders sit, the student also sits in that boardroom. So they are engaging constantly. The leaders are hearing them and they are hearing the leaders. So this communication between all these stakeholders is constantly happening at V-School. That is one way where you can where you can involve them, so and then continue to stay relevant, because they are the ones who are going to really go out there, experience a completely new world from what we have experienced in the past. The other thing that we do is immersion and hands-on practice. So if you look at V-School, even this is something that we share, that even if you have a fresher who comes to the B-School fold, by the time the person has left V-School, they've met at least minimum of 100 industry persons, and not just to exchange cards, but engage with them. They have had close to, more than 100 hours of, apart from their summer internship, engagement with the world of work, working on live projects or working on new challenges. We've set up something called an innovation lab, which we have with MIT Boston earlier. We called it the RedX lab, where right from ideation to prototyping to taking the product to the market, everything is made available to them. So I think what V-School does is be agile about what is the new world requirement or emerging requirement. So earlier on, if it was about learning concepts, applying them, an MBA maybe a decade ago would be judged by how well they spoke and how well they presented their idea. Today, an MBA is not judged only by that. It is about how quickly can you get into the act. I don't have 6 months to train you once you get into my organization. 1 week, I'll be nice to you and then I'm going to ask you, what are you bringing to the table? So, are you ready? So, are you ready for the market space? So, that is the readiness which we have to prepare them for. And as a brand, I think we have been agile and aware of this requirement and prepared them in that direction. I think that helps to keep both the student community as well as the parent community, which is a big stakeholder in the student, completely happy about the direction in which we are headed. And as far as globalization, digital learning, and I think COVID changed the game for all of us. So I'm glad it did, because it then said technology is here and going to stay, and all the naysayers had to experience it also. And the speeding up of embracing of technology really happened. I think that helped us, because we could now multiply this with the help of technology. So a lot of things that we were doing in the offline mode, we also found ways of creating a consistent mode of learning through the digital and online mode. And I think that opened up many more platforms for us, whether it's global. We have global partnerships. We work with a lot of faculty internationally. Students come to Wellinkar. All of that happens. But I think it is, are you relevant with what the industry wants or what the student would like to do, maybe as an entrepreneur or something? So when I go back and look at the data of Wellinkar, we see a lot of institutions put out so-and-so is the MD of an FMCG company, etc. So if you look at most of the Wellinkar alumni, we have a lot of people who are heading technology companies. The PayU founder is from Wellinkar. The new age companies is where you will see vSchool leaders. So I know that they are driving the right engines. And I think that's what we have focused on. We're not focusing on areas where traditional roles are there. If it happens, great. But I think they have to be where the world is headed. We have to prepare them for a world when we are not going to be around. So I think awareness of that and preparation in that direction, whether it is through immersion programs, whether it is through industry connect, very, very important that they be made completely uncomfortable in the 2 years. So the first thing that we tell them is, for the next 2 years, your brains are going to get fried and you are going to possibly hate us and not like us. And when the 2 years are over, you would want to keep coming back to this frying pan. So you have to make them uncomfortable, then the rest of the world doesn't look so difficult.
I think it is important, and clearly that shows up in Wellinkar alums. At least I know many of them because of my connections with them. I, ma'am, came to you again to ask this question with respect to differentiation, more from a point of view, because you started because of your experience in 2000 and all. But if I have to look at, Karan, from your perspective, the student centricity, when you have got a lot of alternatives around, a lot of short-term courses around in the digital space, how do you ensure that you tap the right audience, you keep them in the center and bring them year on year? Because I think you are now managing close to around 5,000 students in these two campuses. So how do you do that?
So I'd like to answer this question. In fact, I'll just come back to your question. Are you asking me from an admissions perspective or from an engagement perspective?
Both, actually both. Because see, they have alternatives. They can go and make themselves available to other institutions as well.
Sure.
From an admission point of view.
Sure.
From an engagement point of view, once they are in, what you do to ensure that they are your word of
sure.
mouth? I would say brand ambassadors.
I think what's been a differentiating factor for IIDE is from an admission standpoint is pure play our digital marketing, personally speaking. So, I can absolutely throw a open room challenge to absolutely anyone in the room right now. If you go to Google and you type up digital marketing course in Mumbai or in Delhi or in Lahore or Karachi or Dubai, pretty much in the top three or four listings, or most likely generally in the top one listing or in the top five listings, you're going to find IID's website out there. So what we seriously managed to do is we figured in COVID that we have no money remaining. You know, from an advertising standpoint, to help improve further admissions as goals for the next year. So we said, you know what, since we're out of advertorial money, it's important to be editorial, or it's important to be organic rather. So SEO, and that comes naturally to me because I am from the SEO era of when Google began. What we nailed literally every potential keyword out there which a student would type, which is a really high intent keyword. For example, you know, like a PG in digital marketing, or a master's in digital marketing, or an MBA in digital marketing. And what that eventually did for us is that our audience pool became super qualified. We got really strong, ambitious, you know, and from a sales angle, we would call this a qualified application, you know. And while that happened, I think that was one of the game changers for us. We did not even have a single online student till 2020. And in under 2 years, we've gone over 2,500 just online learners, you know, at premium ticket values, and like in very short durations, like, you know, 4 months, 6 months, but super premium values. But all of this is done purely through digital marketing. So I think, and apart from that, you know, Instagram is like sensation for your 18 to 21 year olds. I mean, professors, all of us have to tell our students sometimes to drop their phones, right? Yeah, we're on Instagram because of them, right? So, you know, what we really focused on is to create a brilliant community on Instagram and create lots of engaging content, content which is shareable, content which is made by the students for the students. So when you really ace digital marketing from a search, which is Google search, and from social, which is Instagram or LinkedIn, when you really work on these two angles, you're able to genuinely improve conversion rate, which we generally speak about from leads to sales in an education organization. We were really able to nail that. So we moved from a 1% conversion rate to a 3.5% conversion rate without being government recognized, AICT, UGC, or any of these recognized. So for us, that was a game changer. And to engage students while they're admitted into IID, I think we really focused on personalization. So if you come to IID and if you miss a class, you know, you're going to get a ping saying automatically saying, hey, you've missed your class. You missed two classes, you'll get a WhatsApp saying you missed two classes. You missed four classes, your parent will get an email saying your ward has missed classes. So that just, you know, to scare them. But the reality is that we've plugged in personalization absolutely everywhere. You log into an IID dashboard, you log into your app or into your system, the first thing you're going to see as a student is a leaderboard, which is updated every 24 hours. So every student can see, okay, in my batch, I stand fourth, he stands eighth. You know, I'm not actually promoting competition, but they are kind of fostering competition, which I am really taking advantage of, you know. And for me, just plugging in something as simple as a 24/7 live dashboard, a leaderboard, has improved my attendance rate, you know. So we've really drastically worked towards personalization and digitization, absolutely every process. Like even if it's an interview process, we've plugged in an AI tool. We've literally got every question asked in every interview by our students over the last 8 years, plugged them on an AI tool, and then the student is only talking to a web camera and AI is comprehending all of that and telling you, did you answer it well? Or this could have been an alternative answer. So, you know, since we're a new age educational organization, implementation of technology, not just for the sake of, you know, improving efficiency, but we've absolutely engaged technology for the sake of drastically improving personalization, is what is the center of IID. And that's why I think students are actually studying every day, and they are internally actually coming to class and wanting to be better. I think that's what we've done.
So we heard two views largely from a student's point of view. Let me go to Kalyani and understand the faculty point of view, because her program is very niche. finding faculty for a business school or for a university is comparatively easy. I won't say that it's easy, but comparatively easy. But finding faculty for a fitness program is something, I think, if you can share your insights with respect to this stakeholder in the
context. You know, we really have to create our own faculties. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hello. So we have to create our own faculty, and we got teacher training programs for that, and they go on for an 1 year or 1 year max, because you know, we have to make them ready from presentation point of view as well as the content point of view. So getting their stage presence corrected and everything. So the mocks that we take goes on for too many times in the beginning of the program, and then, you know, they become better at it and the program gets the mocks get lesser, but the presentation becomes better and better. So we have to select. So we got certain criteria for selecting the faculties, where they have to score more than 90% in the theory, practical, as well as Viva, and it's not aggregate, it's individual 90%. So all the alumni that have scored 90% can apply for faculty post, and then their program starts. Initially, we also have a panel interview for them, because we want to see from each department head's point of view whether the candidate that standing in front of us can cater to students or not, because all our students are between the age of 20 to 30, and a teacher at that age influences student. So he has to be having a little bit higher maturity level. So that again becomes our problem, because we have lost a couple of our faculties because of maturity, because it's a male dominant field. We got 10% to 15% female students, and those get very much, I would say, infatuated with the teachers. And if the teachers are not conducting themselves with right values, it becomes a problem for institutions. So that also is a bigger problem for us. So the selection process is difficult, it's challenging, but we have to have the students also becoming the teachers. So we are constantly under developing, the process is continuously on. We started with two faculties, that was Kaizad and Mayur, and today we stand at 45 in-house faculties and 15 freelancing faculties. So we also have a section called Pure Sciences, Anatomy, Kinesiology, Physiology, where we do have physiotherapists on board who take those lectures, or we have one more course, which is personal training for special population. For that, the physiotherapists conduct that entire course, but they get taught for the application from exercise point of view from K11 faculty. So yes, it's a continuous ongoing process, and we understand that if I have to grow beyond certain point, we need to have. So right now we were doing the projections, and we need 100 faculties to grow. And that is going to be the next year's complete vision, to develop those faculties.
So I wanted to you to touch on the topic with respect to that. Majority of your faculty is your alum.
Yeah, majority.
It's a big piece. Actually, yeah. I wanted
that. So that's what I explained, that we have a selection process where 90 percentile in theory, practical, Viva can apply for our faculty position. And then there is a panel interview where everybody will throw questions at them to understand whether the maturity levels and the deliverance and everything is there or not.
Yeah.
So that takes time.
Sure. So a couple of points which actually ma'am and Karan both actually alluded with respect to technology. And clearly what Karan said, I completely agree with him with respect to the digital marketing piece, because we also focus a lot on that. And as a company, we help educational institutions to look at that, what they are doing with respect to their marketing spend, where they are spending, how much lead they are generating, what kind of leads they are generating, how they are engaging, what is the personalization quotient of those engagements and all that. And we put a lot of emphasis while we put our product to these educational institutions. Ma'am, I'll come.
Is it okay if I just add one point here? Since you mentioned
since you mentioned about, you know, how the outreach and how much of digital impact the overall, you know, business has, I can tell you that over the last 2 decades, as a business school earlier, the geographies would be limited in terms of the, you know, representation in the student population.
Catchment.
Yes. So, because we are predominantly have been in Bombay and we have a campus in Bangalore, but we've been here for the longest time. So, you would still find a big dominance of Maharashtra, students from Maharashtra. Of course, nationally also, students from Maharashtra dominate the management scenario, apart from a little bit of the north.
North.
What we figured was that, you know, unless you have a pan-India population in a business school, again, you're limiting the thought process and the growth and the willingness to look at a very different, you know, look at things in a very different perspective. So your mindset is highly restricted. You are sitting with another person who's also seen the same things as you. I think digital marketing helped us change that. Okay. From 2017 onwards for us, the entire population, even in the Wellingkar Mumbai campus, while earlier it would be 70 or 30, which is 70 from Western wow. India and mostly Maharashtra, and 30 from rest of India, along with some other strategic changes that we made, the outreach using digital helped make it look more colorful. Where you now have, you know, 40 to 45% or 50% from Maharashtra, but the rest of it is pan India, right from the complete northeast belt to every corner of India, you have students. And I think while that poses a lot of new challenges and new ways in which a B school also has to evolve, but I think that certainly helps the classroom engagement, because now you're sitting with people who don't always think like you and have looked at things like you. So get used to a divergent world kind of a scenario. So I think digital marketing has contributed immensely to look at a talent from every part of India. Yeah,
no doubt about that. In fact, and we are seeing this trend across the board in educational institutions, because we work with them very closely and we know that the mix and the diversity has grown in the last 4-5 years in a big way. But my question was really with respect to technology, and I'll come to you, ma'am, that adoption of technology is a little bit of challenge. I know COVID actually accelerated it, but if you look at it largely from a point of view of adopting a technology at the time of enrolling students, adopting a technology at the time of marketing your programs, all that is still a challenge, because those things were available, but it's not easy to make your existing team train on that or be aware of them, that what it is going to help you in terms of your diversity, in terms of your ensuring right kind of personalization and all that. What has been your experience with respect to adopting technology, mainly from an enrollment lens as well as from a marketing lens?
I represent the Kohinoor Business School, and we run the university affiliated program. So we have very limited control on the process of enrollment, let me tell you. And therefore that puts us in a very difficult spot sometimes on how we are going to use or blend technology, you know, into our enrollment process as well as into the student's experience thereafter. Nonetheless, we have done it. What the students that come to us largely is through the central tests. So we have very limited control on the students that take admission to the program that in the institute that I belong to. However, what we have done is we have to improve the quality of experience of these students. This experience starts right from their entry to the 2-year program, not 2 years, about 1.5 years, to the date of their convocation and beyond. We've tried to integrate technology in each of these experiences of theirs. Number one is, once they enter into the program, what we have done is, and let me tell you that we are also cost controlled because, you know, we are guided by the university and the state norms with respect to the fees that we could charge to the students. So we need to work within these kind of constraints whilst giving maximum benefits and good experience to the students. So what we've done is, the moment they enter the program, we run a small test for them, a psychometric test, if you could call it. And this helps us gauge at a very preliminary level their traits and qualities, which internally we try to map with what could be their career progression moving ahead, and put a right kind of mentor within the organization as well as an alum with them, so that they are able to, we are able to direct their entire career progression in that direction. So this is the entry level. As I told you, we are governed by the state norms as well as the central government norms. And therefore, we cannot make a lot of changes in the curriculum. I'm sure Deepa ma'am will agree to what I'm saying. What we have done is, within the existing curriculum, we have tied up with a lot of national apex industry bodies. Whilst they get their traditional postgraduate degree at the end of their program, throughout the program, we offer them small micro credentials, which is embedded in some of the subjects. So that at the end of the 2-year program, apart from their bigger postgraduate degree, they are also able to get these micro credentials along the way. We've also integrated the NEN network, that is the National Entrepreneurship Network, into some of their subjects, so that, and this is not offered to the entire batch, it's offered to select students who show interest in having their entrepreneurial ventures moving ahead. Apart from this, we also have the innovation and creative creativity cell within the campus. So within the budget constraint, within the available resources, what is the maximum experience that we can give? And finally, beyond. Once our students get into the alumni framework, we engage their services, or we have the alumni engagement to mentor the existing students as well as to map their career progression and the time frame within which they've reached those levels. So this also helps us to map our outcomes and link it to the vision statement. So this is...
Sure. Professor Vijay, what has been your experience with respect to largely the enrollment piece, the admission, the marketing piece, in terms of adoption of technology and how it has benefited your institution?
I think even in the space of higher education, let me be very honest about it, right? Cost has been always cited as one of the major constraints, but I would really focus on the fear of implementation, because you have been always using certain methods which has been used for many years now, and there will be resistance of change for that, for all the stakeholders, in fact, right? And somewhere we are also communicating that whatever the existing methods are or practices are going to be disrupted. So that brings in a lot of change of mindset. So I think somewhere we will have to embrace technology, and it's not just bringing in new technology. You will also have to train the people, and you will have to talk to them about what are the rewards when you're changing the technology, what are the benefits to the overall institution, and how it can be aligned with your vision. So I think that's very important. There are challenges, but there are opportunities. And I think that's more to do with sometimes the cultural shift. Because if the overall culture has been using certain traditional methods, then asking them to change can be very challenging.
Deepa, what has been your experience? Aapne abhi bataya that since 2017, the entire mix, the diversity has gone up at Wellinkar. Do you attribute this to the adoption of technology at the enrollment level, that you started using, started looking at the data in a similar fashion? You know now what kind of leads you are generating from which kind of state in India, what kind of conversions you have. Are you able to mirror all that with whatever you are using in your enrollment system?
100%. So, if I'm not using technology to data mine to understand who is doing what, how are they responding to my messages, I'm really not using it at all. So as far as technology is concerned, I mean, when we started using technology actively, not that we were not using it before, but when we started actively using it in all stages, what we started realizing it was that it was saving me money. I was spending more smartly. And consistently when I do make this kind of a spend, it allows me to, you know, operate at a leader in a leadership position. Okay. If I do this only towards the admission process, then I'm working in a panic mode. And just like, you know, if you want consistent growth, sustainable growth, it's like roz padhai kar lo thoda thoda. So similarly in marketing, and I think he'll agree, whether it's your SEO, whether it's your backlinks, whatever it is, if it's not done in time, that spend is not going to be nurtured adequately. So when we used technology, and yes, when we use NoPaperForms and Meritto and all the software that you have, it certainly helped us make our spends more relevant to the right kind of partners. So you can sometimes be working with multiple partners for reaching out to people, and then that's when you feel you're spending the same money with 10 people, and there is so much of an overlap in the kind of leads or the outreach that they give you. How can I spend my money more effectively? So when you use technology like the one that you have, and there are others, you know, when you offer that you know, to your team and say, now effectively use this and tell me how we should be spending, and he said one of the most important things for you to become creative is scarcity. Jab kuch nahi hota hai, tab dimag sach mein chalta hai. So you have to work with a little bit of that approach that, yes, I don't have resources. How may I now spend this 100 rupees that I have most efficiently? And I think technology plays a fantastic role in helping you do that. Only thing is, you have to open your mind and be willing to engage with technology and ask the right questions, and don't shy away from, you know, a little bit of strife. Whenever you change gears from doing things the way you were doing to doing it in a different way, you're going to feel uncomfortable. And uncomfortable settings will always lead you to something new and better. And in today's age and time, I don't think any business school or education initiative, or for that matter, business, can work minus technology if they want to scale. Unless you want to remain a boutique, you know, shop around the corner, I don't know whether that will also exist without technology. Because even the guy who sells coconut water today is using Paytm and is using WhatsApp. So there is nothing like no technology. It's part of our life. So I think we should view technology like that. And that will help us to really, scale up.
Can I quickly add to that? So just proud to share, you know, we had students from almost 26 states. So it's nothing less than melting point of all the states in India. And I completely agree with the panel. The diverse learnings are always better. And it's because of technology, I would say, one. Second, much before the learners have come in, we have access to certain information and certain data. And of course, it has to be actionable. So you can have better strategies. So we could identify certain students where we can have boot camp much before you start the program. And it does help. So yes, data, if it's actionable, captured in the right manner, but there has to be a strategy in place. So I think it's both the strategy and the structure that would support if technology is rightly chosen.
So let me just add a personal experience. Prior to launching ISME, I was with a leading South Mumbai college, which worked on lists, right? So it was percentages and cutoffs. And therefore, all you needed was Excel. Enter, filter, paste the list, job done. And then when you come into a private education space, every seat is important. right? Because you have to make sure every seat is filled. And I'll share my own experience. So I'm equally a dinosaur, but I was just a Microsoft generation, right? So we didn't know CRMs and things like that. We didn't need to use that as well. And when we launched ISME, we had to get into the space of CRM and all the other technology-driven tools that were there. And I took it upon myself to first overcome this fear, you know, because till you don't play with the CRM software yourself, you cannot train your team. And another best example is tomorrow is my admissions exam. I have 400 applications and, you know, exam takers. And it had it not been for technology, I wouldn't have accepted your invitation to come here on a panel discussion when I'm on the cusp of, you know, taking my admission process. So yes, it has to be adopted. I think we all agree on that. I mean, it's a no-brainer. But the point is, quickly, executively, and of course, like ma'am said, that time is money eventually, so it has to result in something that's going to give you the correct ROI. I think that's what's more important, and thanks God for players like you in the market, because otherwise it's a tough call completely, especially when you scale. You know, in the early stages, it may seem fine, but when as you start scaling, like if I'm looking at 1,000 seats for my undergrad program beginning July, I need technology. Human beings cannot do that job effectively or at all times. So yeah, that was my two bits.
I can go on and on, but I've got a chit here stating that I have overshot my time. Yeah. So I have a couple of questions, but I'm going to put it aside. Yeah. Thank you so much, all of you, for sharing your thoughts, coming here, spending time. I know during the day also people will learn a lot from all of you. So once again, thank you so much for joining here.